Hello again, fellow YouTubers and Card Fight fans. I am Solomon Pleasant, back with another Card Fight Vanguard deck profile, and it could be anything. It could be anything. I don't have a problem. It's not like I have the deck box or anything. I don't have a problem. It's not like I have the sleeves or anything. I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem. It's Granblue. We'll be reviewing Granblue today. That is what we are reviewing today. And considering I did put a boatload of money, and by boatload I mean more than I usually do into this, I might as well show off everything I have, so this is the deck box. It's a pretty cool deck box. This is the playmat. All of this kind of stuff was obtained at the regionals that I failed at, and I dropped the deck box. I'm awesome. Definitely. Quality content. And this is double-sleeved, and it feels nice. Considering these cards are cold, because they've been in my car for who knows how long. Anyway. So. This is my Night Rose Granblue deck profile. So let's go ahead and look at that. So for our starter, hopefully the light doesn't reflect too much off that, we have Undying Departed Grenache as our 5k starter. With the Forerunner ability, the Hollow ability, which if you don't know or don't play Granblue, when this unit is placed on rearguard, you may have it hollowed. If you do, it dies at the end of the turn. This has the Ginbreak 1 ability of, if this unit is put into the drop zone from rearguard due to the effect of the Hollow ability, countercharge 2, as in unflip 2 damage. This is a fantastic starter, and this really gives you off some great combos. Even though he is a 5k, it's still great to have him as a starter. Just because once you get him out with your other abilities, he really helps you unflip the damage that you need to unflip for next turn. Fantastic starter. Moving on to our triggers. I run two stand triggers of Mick the Ghosty and family. I run two of the crit trigger, Cody the Ghosty. I run four of Ruffsy's Banshee. I run four of, if I could just, yeah, there we go, Rampage Shade, and of course, four of the Good Luck Charm Banshee Heal trigger. So, starting off with our Mick the Ghosty and family. It has the Hollow ability and the Ginbreak 1 of, when this unit is placed on rearguard from the drop zone, if this unit is hollowed, you may choose up to one of your other units and give it plus 10 till the end of the turn. And this unit gets the auto ability of, when this unit is put in the drop zone from rearguard, return this card to the deck and then shuffle your deck. This is a fantastic card. Because not only do you get a stand back in your deck, but you're also getting plus 10 to something, and it can be a 4k booster, because it only has to die at the end of the turn. Would have been better as a crit? Maybe, but it's still fantastic as a stand, because, you know, stands get you an extra attack, and that's good sometimes. So, I run two of these. I think it's good to run two, at least. I run two of Cody the Ghosty, because I didn't want to run four stands, so I figured I'd just run two of this crit trigger, which has the auto drop zone counterblast one ability of, when your unit without Ghosty in its card name is put in the drop zone for rearguard, you may pay the cost. If you do, call this to an open rearguard. So, I think what Cody is meant to be used for is to fill up space so that you don't have a completely empty field, but I don't know, Granblue actually can benefit off empty fields, so I haven't really used his ability that much. Let's see. It's put into your drop zone from rearguard. Okay, so it's after something dies, so I guess you could set up another row if you manage to get off a combo of calling out another unit, but it varies. I mean, he can work with Blue Heart, but I don't usually use him. He's just there for extra crit. I run four of Ruffsy's Banshee, which if you don't know, it's the Act Rearguard ability to put her in the soul, draw a card. If you have a Granblue Vanguard, obviously. Then I run four of the Rampage Shade, which is the Now, standard double rare critical that says auto rearguard put in the soul. If you have a Vanguard, when your Vanguard attacks, if you have Night Rose in its name, so it has a specified name, put in the soul, draw a card, and get plus 5,000 power. It's a staple in a lot of decks that actually have an archetype, so run four of that. And then four heal trigger, because G-Guards are a thing. Up next, the Grade 1s. I run four Waterspout Djinns. I don't know. Two of Bale the Ghosty. An obvious four of Tommy the Ghosty Brothers. And four of Witch Doctor of Powdered Bone. Yeah, Powdered Bone Negro Bone. And I'm just going to say this right now. Some of the cards for Granblue seem a bit risque with their names. It's weird. Anyway, so an obvious 4 P-Guard, because in order to have a meta deck, I guess you have to have 4 P-Guards. Waterspout Djinn has the common P-Guard ability of if you have a copy of him in the drop zone, unflip a damage after you guard with him. So it's a standard P-Guard nowadays. So not much to say about that. Have a copy of him in the drop zone, unflip damage. Pretty useful in this deck, because this deck counterblasts so much. And I'll just get right out of the way that Tom and the Ghosty Brothers are the stride fodder with the ability of place it on rearguard. Hey, you don't have your grade 3 rearguard with Night Rose in its name? Look for it. And also, it's basically a grade 3 when you stride. Pretty standard. So for the cards that actually do something that aren't as standard, I run two Bale the Ghosties. Bale the Ghosty first has the Gen Break 1 ability of when he's placed on rearguard from the drop zone, he gets plus 2 until the end of the turn, becoming a 9k. Kind of useful, because he doesn't have to boost or attack, he just gets plus 2 power, which makes him pretty valuable. He's also a normal ghost unit, so that I don't always have to fish out Tommy the Ghosty Brothers from the drop zone. But also, he has the auto ability of when this unit is put at the bottom, put this unit at the bottom of your deck from the drop zone, for when he goes to the drop zone from rearguard during a battle phase, if you have a Vanguard with Night Rose in its name, you may pay the cost. If you do, unflip a damage. So, the way you use Bale is essentially either you place him there, and then during a battle phase, you swap him out with a different unit, and then if you have Night Rose as your Vanguard in some way, you essentially can unflip a damage, which can be very helpful. So the best way to utilize Bale is to either attack with him or boost with him, and then send him back to the drop zone and replace him with the different units, and either give that unit power or something of that nature. But you have to do it during the battle phase. You can't do it during the main phase. That's the only downside. Also, Bale actually is useful during any battle phase. So if Bale is in the front row and he's somehow attacked, which, given Granblue and Vanguard nowadays, people are just smart enough not to attack rearguards because it's kind of pointless in this version of Granblue, but if someone were to attack, say, they attack the front row. When Bale dies, I get to unflip damage by putting him back in the deck because I would have a Night Rose's Vanguard. So, I run two of them. He's a good tech guard. And I run four of... Ah, God. Witch Doctor of the Powered Bone, Negro Bone. Yeah, seriously, they are really being risky with that. It is a Gen Break, Counterblast, Gen Break 1, Counterblast 1. At the end of the battle that this unit boosted a rearguard, if you have a Vanguard with Night Rose in its name, you can pay the cost. If you do, retire the unit that this unit boosted during that battle, and then choose up to one card with the holo ability from the drop zone and call to rearguard. So, again, this is a good way to get off other attacks. Grant, he doesn't work with Bale, but he works really well with most of my Grade 2 lineups since they all have the holo ability. Except for one. But very good for getting off extra attacks or for just racking out, basically for getting off extra attacks, if you have the Carrot Blast to do so. I use him more just as a basic booster, but he's still pretty good for getting off extra attacks if I want to get off an extra attack. Moving on to Grade 2s. I run two Skeleton Cannoneer. Three Witch Doctor of the Rotten Seas Negro Rook. Two pirate swordsman Columbard. And 4, witch doctor of Langur Negrolazy. Seriously, these names. What? Why? Why these names? Anyway, so starting off, 2 Skeleton Cannoneer has the hollow ability, and the Gen Break Counterblast 1. When this unit is placed on rearguard from the drop zone, you can pay the cost. If you do, choose up to 1 of your opponent's rearguards and retire it. Then, if this unit is hollow, draw cards. So, since you want to basically hollow your stuff every turn, because why would you keep it on the field when you can just call it out next turn? You not only retire a unit, but get a free card. That's what makes this card good. This card is fantastic for this deck, but you don't want to run too many because it'll clog the deck down, and also he's only a 9k. Also because you want some beat sticks like Witch Doctor of the Rotten Seas Negro Rook, who has the Hollow Engine Break 1 ability of when this unit attacks, this unit gets plus 2,000 power until the end of the battle, and then if this unit is hollowed, give it another plus 5. So this is a standard, hollow it, give it more power. It can either be an 11k, or it can turn into a 16k just by hollowing it, which makes it a very good powerhouse and or finisher card. I then run 2 of the Pirate Swordsman Columbard, who has the only non-hollow ability of Gen Break 1, you counterblast 1 when he attacks. If he was boosted this turn, you may choose up to 1 card from your drop zone and just call it to rearguard. A very good way to get out another attacker, so that you're not just relying on Negrobone to get out cards from your drop zone. Very useful. I don't utilize him as much, but he is still good for early game and mid game pressure. Or should I say mid game pressure, because early game you don't stride, so. Finally, 4 Witch Doctor of Le Cure Negrolazy, who has the Hollow ability and the Gen Break of 1 of Counterblast and Soul Blast 1. Choose when this unit is placed on rearguard. If you have Vanguard with Night Rose in its name, you may pay the cost. If you do, choose up to 1 grade 2 or less card, not named this specific card right here, from your drop zone, call to rearguard, give it plus 2. Until the end of the turn, this unit gets plus 2, and the auto ability of when this unit is put in the drop zone from the effect of a hollow ability, countercharge 1 and soul charge 1. So you get to unflip damage and soul charge damage, which basically makes this a free card, essentially. So, he becomes an 11k swinger, he dies at the end of the turn, but you get to unflip a damage and soul charge, which is kind of useful in Grand Blue. It's a little bit useful. Not the most. I mean, it's not the biggest thing you rely upon, but it is a thing to remember to do. So, that's the grade 2 lineup, mostly consisting of hollow abilities, as you can tell, because that's where your bread and butter comes from calling out units. You really want to call out those grade 2s. Sometimes you gotta call out grade 3s, and this is where these guys come in. From our grade 3 lineup, I run 3 Mighty Rogue Nightstorm, 1 Great Skipper Supreme Skulger, and an obvious 4 of Vampire Princess of the Night Fog Night Rose. Don't call this from the drop zone, there's no point. Now, first off, we will look at Mighty Rogue Nightstorm, who has the hollow ability and the auto rearguard gen break 1 counterblast 1 of at the end of the battle, if this unit attacked a vanguard, if this unit is hollowed, you won't pay the cost. If you do, choose up to 1 card not named this card from your drop zone call to rearguard that this unit is not on. So, essentially, he can get another attack off after he attacks. He also has the auto counterblast and soul blast 1 of when he's placed on vanguard, you may pay the cost. If you do, look at the top 5 cards, look for one with the hollow ability, reveal it to your opponent, put it in your hand, and then shuffle your deck. It's an eh card. It's decent. It's not the worst thing in the world. I sometimes wonder why I have 3 of it, but then I remember, oh yeah, because I don't want to overrun on this guy. Speaking of which, this is the grade 3 that I think of first when I think of calling a grade 3 from the drop zone. Great Skipper Supreme Skulger, who has the hollow ability and the continuous gen break 1 ability of if the number of cards with the hollow ability in your drop zone is 4 more, he gets plus 2. Then, if this unit is hollowed, it gets plus 2. It becomes a 15k swinger by itself. Then, put 2 cards from your deck into the drop zone. When this unit is placed on vanguard or rearguard, you may pay the cost. If you do, this unit gets plus 2. So, In theory, this unit can become a 17k swinger, I believe. Yep. A 17k swinger just by hollowing it and putting milling two cards in the drop zone. Overall, pretty good. I only won run of this guy because I never want to ride this guy's Vanguard. He's useless on Vanguard. He really is. There's not much of a point. When you play him on Vanguard, you can get plus two, but other than that, it's kind of pointless. So I only run one of Skulgur. And then the obvious four of Night Rose, who has the once per turn Gen Break 2 ability of put the top three cards of your deck into the drop zone, and then when your rear guard is put into the drop zone, you may pay the cost. If you do, you may call that card to rear guard. It's a very interesting card that I don't really use this Gen Break 2 ability, but I do use this auto counterblast, auto on Vanguard counterblast one. When she gets strode upon, I may choose up to one card from my drop zone, call to rear guard, and give plus two. I really don't use the secondary ability because mostly in this kind of deck, I'm striding most of the time. I'm getting out very consistent strides, but I will say that this is kind of useful if you're trying to get cards in and out of the drop zone. It's a way to do it. Also, this effect of getting out an extra unit, giving plus two, very effective because you can get out your Negro Lazy, your Negro Rook, pretty much anything you need in order to help get your field bigger for your attack. You ride this, you call this guy out, you have this guy's backup. That's essentially how it is. And now on to the stride deck. My hands were supposed to be in there to kind of... It's okay. So, first, one Ghosty Great King Obadiah, or as I like to say, King Boo. One Pirate King of the Abyss, Blue Hearts. Two Demon Sea Queen, Merid. Four of your obvious go-to stride, Mist Phantom Pirate King, Night Rose. Four of your Tempest Calling Pirate King. Oh, God, how am I going to say this name? Tempest Calling Pirate King, Ghosh? I think it's Ghosh. And then I run for G-Guards, one Metal Elemental Screw, one Witch... Great Witch Doctor of Banquet's Negro Lily, and two Eclipse Dragon Hulk Deep Corpse Dragon. God, these names are weird. So, first, run one great ghosty great king, King Boo. He has the auto ability of when this unit is placed on Vanguard, you may search your deck for up to three cards, put them in the drop zone, shuffle your deck, and if two or more of those cards have the holo ability, two or more cards with the holo ability were put into the drop zone this way, by this effect, you can choose up to one normal unit with ghosty in its name from the drop zone, call to rear guard in the same column as this unit. So, this gets out Bale. And that's pretty much it because that's the only normal ghost unit I have in this deck. So, I normally don't stride him unless I don't see myself needing to use Counterblast, or I've already used these guys. He's also good for if I need to mill cards into my drop zone. So, say I'm having a bad game where I haven't put that many cards in the drop zone, or I just haven't played many cards. Or, say I just have nothing but triggers in the drop zone because all I've been doing is guarding. He is good for getting other units in the drop zone that I actually want in the drop zone. So that's why I run one of him. I run one Pirate King of the Abyss Blue Heart, who has the once per turn act ability of Counterblast 1, choose two cards from your drop zone, and call them to separate rear guards with units on them. So, here's some things about Blue Heart. One, he is good for killing off units like Grenache. Or any or any of my units that are stuck on the field at the moment. He's good for getting rid of those units that are just stuck there and they can't do anything, and it can give you some different units. Or you can just kill Grenache with one of your units and then call Grenache back and unflip 2 damage, because you're allowed to do that with Blueheart. Another thing about Blueheart, no, he cannot get rid of your locked units. It says call it on occupied rearguard, and as we all know, locked units don't exist there. So the rearguard just doesn't exist. People always trying to find ways around lock. Maybe it's because it's broken. That's a good question. Anyway, I usually actually start out with him or Mildred. Usually him, because he's actually a very good first turn, because I just counterblast one and I get 2 units out. Pretty simple, pretty good opener. I only run 2 Mildreds just because, A, you need to copy a Mildred in order to even activate her effect, which I know that's hard to read, so this is why I read them out for you. She has the act turn 1, counterblast 1, choose a face-down card from your G-zone, turn it face-up, choose a card from your hand, and discard it. And then choose the same number of normal units from the drop zone as the number of face-up units with her name in it. So, essentially, she's a one-turn Persona Blast, because I can't use her after that. In the G-zone, with the sum of grades being 4 or less, call them to separate rearguard, and then increase this unit's power by the original power of the unit called until the end of the turn. So what you do with Mildred is, if you're first turning Mildred, you stride her, you counterblast, you use her skill, you discard a card, and then you essentially can get out a grade 3, grade 2, or grade 1, or hell, you can even get out Grenache if you want to get that extra soul unflip off. And you give her power. She's really good for getting an extra unit out, and also for an early game push. I haven't been using her as much because I found Blueheart to be very useful. But she still is a relatively decent card to have if you want to help get off Ghosh's effect near the endgame. So, that's why I run 2 of her. Now, my main mid-game to late-game stride would be Miss Phantasm Pirate King Night Rose, which that should be Queen. I'm just going to point that out. She has the ability of Genbreak 2, Counterblast 2, choose a copy of her, turn it face up. When she attacks a Vanguard, you may pay the cost. If you do, choose 2 cards from your drop zone and call them to separate rearguards in different rows. Now, rows are the front row and the back row. Columns are each column. I had a hard time with this at first, but once you figure it out, it makes a little bit more sense. So, a column to different rows, you call one to the front, one to the back, that's just how that works. Very good for mid-game to late-game, because what she allows you to do is essentially get out 2 units for only a counterblast 2, which, hey, did you get out Grenache as one of your units? Guess what, you did that for free then. Because he unflips 2 when he dies anyway. So, very good for your mid-game to late-game, and that's why she's so expensive. And now for late-game, Tempest Calling Pirate King Grenache. Ghosh. Yeah, it's Ghosh. Grenache is the grade 0. He has the auto, counterblast 1, soulblast 1, choose a face-down copy of him, turn it face-up. When this unit is placed on Vanguard, you may pay the cost. If you do, choose up to 5 cards from your soul, put them into the drop zone, and then choose the same number of cards from the drop zone, and put that many cards from the drop zone. Basically, after you counterblast and soulblast 1, turn a copy of him face up, choose up to 5 cards from your soul, up to 5, put them in the drop zone, and take that same amount of cards and put them on different rear guards. And then they get +1 power for each face up unit in the G zone. The reason you use them late game is after you use both your Miss Phantasm Pirate Kings to get 4 out, you used Blueheart giving you 5, you've essentially G guarded once or twice, giving you 7, maybe. And say you used Madrid, that puts you at 9. Plus an extra copy of him, that's a +10. That's a +10. That's why you use him late game. My only pet peeve with this card is that it's a soul blast. It really undermines and makes the effects even more costly. I can understand a Counterblast 2 instead of a Counterblast 1, the Soul Blast 1. Because it drains your soul and then you don't get to do as much. I just really hate that it's a Soul Blast 1. If it was a Counterblast 2, I'd be a little more accepting of it, but we already have a card with Soul Blast Counterblast 2. So I guess it's okay to Soul Blast 1, which that's why you run things like Rupsy's Banshee and Necrolazy, so that you can get cards back into your soul. So overall, this is used to finish the game. Because you can essentially get off one to five units in theory, but from what I've seen it, I can get off 2 to 3 units with around plus 9, which is actually very, very concerning, because you can call them anywhere, really. And finally, for G-Guardians, first I run 2 of this really long-named Undead Dragon thing, which, when you put them into the guard zone, you can mill the top 2 cards of your deck, and if you do, give it plus 5, making it a 20k shield instead of a 15k shield, so that's actually pretty useful. This is the one you want to start with, because... that is shiny. This is the one you start with because, A, it gets stuff in your drop zone, and B, these two are more specific for later in the game when attacks become more powerful. This one, being Witch Doctor Banquet's Necrolily, has the auto Counterblast 1 ability and choose a rearguard and retire it, which, making Grenache even more worth, this is one of the most worth starters I think I've ever seen. And what she does is essentially, when you retire a unit, when you pay the cost, you can choose up to one normal unit with Ghost Dance name, so Bale or Tommy, from the drop zone, call to open rearguard, and then this unit gets plus 10,000 power. So you get a unit back that, again, if you retire Grenache, you essentially just upped your value and put Grenache in the drop zone, making him even more useful, because he's more useful there than he is on rearguard. And you got even more shield, making this a 25k by itself. I only run one of this because I really do like Screw, and I like having 2 of this Corpse Dragon. So that's why I only run one. Although, I could see someone running 2 of this. I can understand it. And finally, we have Metal Elemental Screw, who has the continuous ability of its Cray Elemental. It gets to be in all clans and nations. It has the odd ability of choose a card from your hand and discard it. Blah, blah, blah. Oh, choose a card from your hand and discard it. When this unit is placed on G-Zone, if the number of face-up cards in your G-Zone is 1 or more, you may pay the cost. If you do, this unit gets plus 10,000 power until plus 10,000 shield, so this can also become a 25k shield by discarding a card, which in Grand Blue, hey, that's more beneficial than not discarding a card. So, the way you play this deck is you ride it out until you're at Grade 3, you ride your Night Rose, which, if you don't ride Night Rose, you're kind of screwed. Although I have ridden Night Mist once or twice and been pretty effective with it, actually, just because the strides are very powerful, and Pirate Phantasm King doesn't actually need Night Rose as her heart in order to work, which makes that even more busted. But essentially what I do is get Night Rose at Grade 3, start striding, and if my opponent's still alive after I've used both my Mist Phantasms, go into Grenache, and then just go beat face. Gauche is the Grade 4, Grenache is the awesome Grade 0 that I essentially call out almost every time I can, because I get to unflip 2 damage. I essentially, for free, most of my skills, because most of my skills are either Counterblast 1 or Counterblast 2, and he unflips 2 damage. I do it for free, basically, making him a fantastic starter. He is only a 5k, but it's so easy to buff him up that it's essentially worth just sacrificing 2k, considering most of my Grade 1s are 7ks anyway. It just makes it worth. It really does. MVP starter, right here. This comes in the trial deck. That's awesome. So, this has been my Grand Blue deck profile. I was really holding this one back because I wanted to just test it out to make sure that everything was right before I did a profile of it. And I think I'm at a comfortable position where I'm like, yeah, this seems pretty good until the next set drops and then I have to just change everything. But other than that, This has been Solomon Pleasant from my channel. Yay. And this has been my awesome Night Rose deck profile. Peace.